If you watch this video, you will see how I transformed this terrarium into this enclosure. Hi again. This time I'm back with a video which is going to be a bit of a terrarium renewal and a bit of a DIY video. Since we had to euthanize both of my Savannah monitors, two of my biggest enclosures are free and empty. I decided to make both of them look better and give one of them to my Tegu and the other to my Argus monitor. In our video today, we are going to prepare the new enclosure for Sarah. I chose the bottom cage for her because of two reasons. One is that it has ledges which monitors actively use, the other is that these lizards tripod, which the top enclosure wouldn't allow due to its height. Since my Argus monitor is a female, this enclosure can be her final cage, so I really want to make it look good and fit her well at the same time. What do we have to do with this enclosure? We need to make two hides and a water bowl. The hides I'm going to make smaller, as reptiles tend to feel more secure in tighter, small places. The water bowl will be a final size mini pond, which will be enough even for an adult female Argus monitor to fit in. These props will be made with a technique I haven't showed you before, but I'm pretty sure you will love it as it provides an easy and cheap solution for making your own accessories for your reptiles. Lastly, we will add a lot of fake plants to the enclosure to make it look awesome. Alright, let's go! The first task will be to create the hides and the water bowl. The plan is to get plastic boxes for the hides and plastic plates for the bowl. For the hides, we'll do the following. We turn the boxes upside down, then spray them entirely with expanding foam. Once the foam has dried out, we carve it with a knife. We have to carve the foam because of two reasons. First, we want to give a hide a naturalistic, rocky-like appearance, and secondly, we need to get rid of the foam's smooth surface entirely, so the cement we will apply can get a grip. Under the original surface of the foam, there is a porous material filled with smaller, bigger holes created by air bubbles. These holes trap the cement easily, making it easy to add even the first layer. For the bowl, we'll use two of these plates. You can easily get these anywhere. These ones are for holding excess water under plant pots. You don't need to get exactly these, the point is to find something that holds water and two of the same pieces can be fit into each other. One is going to be sprayed with expanding foam, just like the hides. That piece will be the one carved and cemented. That piece will hold the second plate in place. The second plate will be the one holding the water that we will be able to take out and clean in case we need to. Both hides and the bowl has to go under the same procedures, so we will create them one after the other. Okay, let's continue with starting the cement work. We will apply multiple layers of cement, each layer's consistency will be different from the other. The first layer will be a thin crust serving as a base as cement gets a grip easier on dried cement than the expanding foam surface. For the first layer, we'll create a liquid mixture with a consistency close to milk and we'll apply it with a brush. We have to make sure that we apply this layer perfectly on the entire surface of all of our structures, filling all the little air holes. Once we are done, we leave everything to dry for a few hours. Since this layer is very thin, it won't take too long till we can continue working with our props. The second layer will give our props the first line of defense, mass and durability. This mix's consistency should be thick, not as liquid as the first one, and we shall apply it with a spoon. Depending how hard the surface has to be, we determine the thickness of the layer. If you want to make structures for gecko species, even the second layer can be thin, but we are making props for a hyperactive monitor here, so the second layer we aim to apply a centimeter thick. Adding a large volume of cement can result in losing the original shape we created, but I aim to keep the main features anyways. A third layer we can apply to re-add some lost shapes or create new ones. Once the desired mess is applied, shaping is the next task we have to do. The applied coat will dry smooth, especially if the cement is 100% pure without little rock pieces. If that is what you prefer, good, but I want my prop surface to be rough. This I get by pressing another rough material onto the drying cement. This rough material can be a piece of stone, wood, but my favorite method is using a wet towel. It needs to be wet so the cement doesn't stick to it. While pressing the towel down, you can still add formations, extra shapes, with also turning the surface into a rough stone-like material. Another method to achieve a similar but slightly different look is using a dry brush to roughen the surface. For this, both the cement and the brush have to be dry, so you can scrape only a little cement off of the structure. Don't let the cement dry out completely, you won't be able to shape it when it's rock hard. I also like to use a knife cutting little cracks and crevices into the prop. A lot of them will disappear when the paint is applied, but some will stay visible, giving the hide extra details and a more naturalistic look. When all the shaping is done, there is nothing else left but to leave the cement to dry completely. The thicker the layers, the longer the drying will take. Don't let your structures under extreme heat. Too fast drying will make the surface crack. Spray the surface with water if the cement dries too fast. I usually get some cement in excess, which I like to use for something, as I like to leave nothing to waste. This time I made two artificial rocks, which will serve as a stand for fake plants. These are flat and have a good weight, so the monitor won't turn them over easily. The next part is to paint our structures. I use the same exterior paint for every project of mine, which are for land-dweller animals, from tropical or dry environment, no matter what. For aquariums or paludariums, I use different kind of techniques. This paint is used for painting the exterior walls of buildings, its heat resistance and waterproof. Even water resistance on an extent, if the painted surface does not stand in water continuously. Just like with the cement, we are going to apply multiple layers of paint as well. The first layer will be a simple white coat, which will serve as a protective shield for the cement surface. Apply the paint generously, as the dried out cement will suck the paint in like sponge. Fear not, that is a good thing, this will make sure that our prop surface will be resistant and cleanable. When the first coat is applied, we let it dry completely. I like to leave it to dry for 12 to 24 hours, depending on my room's temperature. Once it dries, we apply the second white coat to finish sealing the cement. This layer will dry slower, as the treated surface will suck the paint in much slower. Try to apply the paint evenly, with watching not to overuse it, apply as much as your structure can absorb. We leave this one to dry for another day to be sure. The third and final protective layer will also serve as the base color of our prop, so we add liquid colorizer to our white paint. I like to use darker tones for the base, lightening it with the new layers. We have to keep in mind that when the paint dries, the final layer's color will be darker, so we shouldn't mix the paint too dark initially. I like to use steps with the brush when applying the color coat, so when it dries, the swipe lines of the brush won't be visible. If we would just add the paint with swipes, the surface would look unnatural in the end. This layer will need another 24 hours to dry completely. Now we've arrived to the point when we give the final look for our props. We will use dry brush technique and add features using the paint colorizers. As I add these coloring layers, I focus on adding lighter and lighter colors as we approach the final layer. First, we use an ochre, mixed in some brown and base red, and lightening it up with yellow. We keep the dark tone of the base red for the cracks and crevices and use highlights for the plateaus. For the very edges, I use pure white with the same dry brush technique. This is the phase where everyone can go crazy, adding the personally desired color variations. Remember, this is mostly for your own entertainment. Your animal won't really bash you for not having the most naturalistic color combinations if the baseline conditions are provided. All these are for you to feel good when you look at your enclosures. So we completed the props, we can move forward. Since all the hides, the water bowl are brand new, I think it's time to give a little overpaint to this old background to renew the colors a bit. For that, we'll use the same colors as we used for the props. We are in the finish line now. We need lights. The enclosure has three sockets. One will hold an Exoterra 80 watt solar grow for the heat and much needed UVB, another one an intense basking 75 watt for more heat, and the third will hold a 50 watt neodymium bulb for heat and another spectrum of light. You know that I like to cover the bulbs so the strong light doesn't bother the people in the living room. For this, I came up with a new and simple solution. We will use bathroom hangers to hold the banana leaf covers in place. The hangers have a sticky base which can be attached to the ceiling of the enclosure. We drill a hole into the hangers where we stuck the metal handle of the banana leaves and that's it. Keep in mind, this solution works only if the animal can't reach the covers as they are bent and torn down easily with this securing method. As of substrate, we will divide the enclosure to two parts. Under the heat lamps, we will provide a sandy area, while on the other side, there will be a substrate mix of cocoa fiber and mulch. Under the water area, pure cocoa fiber is placed to suck up the water the animal may spill out. The two areas we divide with a line of piled stones where the cracks and holes are filled with mulch, so the sand won't be able to escape from one side to the other. All the substrate, the stones, everything is cleared and sanitized by heat. To raise the aesthetics, we will use fake plants and a piece of good-looking wood which I already placed into the oven for 30 minutes to get rid of parasites. Since this is going to be a larger body lizard, we have to be prepared with durable fake plants or with pieces we can replace fast and cheap. This monitor species is extremely active, likes to dig, checks everything out, so plants should be secured properly. That's why I even use silicone to glue some of the plants to the background. And this is the point when we are done. I think the outcome is great, everything looks amazing. This is the time to take a lot of pictures, to make videos, cause once the little devil moves in, it will never be the same again. She will mix some of the substrate, turn some stones, change everything while exploring her new territory. But in the end, we created all this so she can feel good in her new home. Well, that was it for today. I think it was a huge accomplishment and it was worth all the effort. This is the quality, the level, which I intend to keep all my animals at, so you can expect a lot of terrarium makeovers like this in the future. As for Sarah, there is nothing else left but to move into her newly created gorgeous place, but that will be in another video. I hope you've enjoyed this one and you'll come back for the next episode of Project Pet as well. See ya!